Okay, could I encourage members who are leaving the chamber and those in the public gallery who are leaving to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible as we move on to the next item of business. If I could encourage those leaving the public gallery in particular to do so as quickly and quietly as possible. The next item of business is a members' business debate on motion 8579 in the name of Bill Kidd on Firefighters Memorial Day 2023. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Bill Kidd to open the debate around 7 minutes. Mr. Kidd.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. It's a privilege to lead today's debate recognising Firefighters Memorial Day 2023. This is a day dedicated to the sacrifice of firefighters who have lost their lives in the line of duty, both here in Scotland and internationally. In fact, the day is also known as International Firefighters Day, where the world community can recognise and honour the sacrifices that firefighters make to ensure that their communities and environment are as safe as possible. The day began after the tragic incident in Australia, Linton, Australia, on December the 2nd, 1998. On that day, five volunteers who were part of a strike team called in to assist in tackling wildfires headed out from the fire they were tackling to refill their tanker when a sudden violent wind change engulfed the truck in flames. Tragically, all five members of the strike team were killed. In response, Lieutenant Firefighter and fellow volunteer Jai Jai Edmondson resolved to work with international colleagues to establish an internationally recognised symbol of support and respect for all firefighters. Internationally, the 4th of May was chosen to coincide with the Day of St Florian, the patron saint of all firefighters, who was the first known commander of one firefighting squad in the Roman Empire. And he lost his life along with those of his colleagues protecting the same humane ideas which firefighters across the world share today. Since the inaugural Firefighters Memorial Day, support for this initiative has grown to be truly global, with events and services being held across the world to mark this day and this event. Here in the Scottish Parliament, the overwhelming member support for today's motion across this chamber has been remarkable, sending out a clear message of the huge respect we all share for those risking their lives every day in protection of our communities. And I would like to thank all the members for that support, along with those here in the chamber today and speaking, and I look forward to listening to their contributions. We all know the risks involved, of course. We were recently given a tragic reminder of these risks when, sadly, when tackling the horrendous blaze at Jenners in Edinburgh, firefighter Barry Martin was fatally injured while two other colleagues were taken to hospital for smoke inhalation treatment. We were also all incredibly moved by the solidarity and support from his colleagues as crews lined up across the country and thousands lined the Royal Mile as the procession passed this Parliament to pay their respects. It was a poignant reminder also in Edinburgh of only 15 years ago when they performed the same sad duty for their colleague Ewan Williamson, who tragically died while attending the fire in the Balmoral Bar. Today we pay our respects to all those who have lost their lives in the line of duty, and while praise must be given for the steps taken to improve safety, the banner which hangs in the head offices of the Fire Brigades Union in Scotland, with the names of almost 2,500 firefighters who have lost their lives, is a testament to the fact that one life lost is one too many. That we cannot be complacent, and that as a firefighter's work evolves, these safety measures must also evolve. Indeed, the risk created by changes to construction methods and materials such as composite cladding and new risks that result from firefighters' involvement in non-traditional work, such as water and rope rescue, not to mention the effects of climate change, make this imperative. I support calls for the FBU by the FBU for politicians, chief fire officers and firefighters to work together to ensure that as practices evolve, safety and legislation evolve also to reflect this new reality. This new reality includes hidden risks recently acknowledged by the World Health Organization of the increased instances of mortality from firefighters dying of cancers and other diseases attributed to firefighting as an occupation. And that's why I also support and commend the FBU's recent decon campaign to help firefighters protect themselves and others from harmful contaminants. The campaign calls for annual monitoring to exposure for occupation to be recorded on health, death certificates and similar records, for decon training and policy to be introduced across the UK, for facilities and contracts for PPE and workwear cleaning, and for legislation to ensure proper compensation and protection for affected firefighters. I hope that campaigns such as this and other measures can form a basis for discussions on the future shape of our rescue services. I'd like to also commend the FBU for its Red Plaques project, which creates memorials for firefighters who have lost lives in the line of duty, with each red plaque commemorating a moment in local history and offering a place of reflection for the community. Each red plaque is funded by the hugely worthy Firefighters 100 lottery, and since its commencement, this lottery has funded the establishment and presentation of red plaques remembering over 50 firefighters across the UK, unfortunately with some very notable locations in my own city of Glasgow. There is a quote on the medal handed out by the FBU to long-standing activists. On it, it states, "Remember the dead, fight for the living." I think in this chamber we all agree we were elected here to do just that. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, firefighters protect our lives and we must do everything we can to protect theirs. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kidd. Before we move to the open debate, just a gentle reminder to those who haven't yet pressed the request to speak buttons to do so now. And I call first Russell Finlay to be followed by Ruth Maguire. Around 4 minutes, Mr. Finlay.
Thank you, President Officer. I thank Bill Kidd for bringing forward today's debate to mark Firefighters Memorial Day. As a fellow citizen of Glasgow, we're both familiar with its history of high profile and often deadly infernos, a long and tragic history, sometimes earning the label of Tinderbox City. You don't have to look far to see the legacy of incidents in which gallant firefighters and others lost their lives. The Firefighters Heritage Trail comprises 12 memorial plaques around the city in which firefighters died on duty. One of those was the Cheapside Street fire disaster of March 28, 1960, in which 14 firefighters and 5 Salvage Corps officers lost their lives following a massive explosion at a whisky bond. I used to live in nearby James Watt Street, in which 22 members of the public were killed in 1968. And with plans to extend the trail, I hope this tragedy will be amongst those to be included. Now, the ferocity and scale of such horrors seems unimaginable, almost sepia-tinted history. Fire safety has become central to our lives, in our homes and our workplaces, with decades of improvements making us safer than ever before. During a recent trip to Paisley Fire Station, I saw some of the incredible equipment now being used. And today, I watched a video about new technologies which promise so much. In future, firefighters will almost certainly be supported by augmented reality. They'll be able to see on their visors digital information superimposed on the physical world in front of them, vital information about distances and layouts within smoke-filled buildings, the location of exits, and their own colleagues. But technology and human endeavour cannot fully end the risk posed by fire and smoke. Despite our many advances, tragedies still occur, as we saw in January, when firefighters were called to the former General's Department store here in Edinburgh. 5 of those who entered the building required hospital treatment. These included 38-year-old Barry Martin, who tragically succumbed to his injuries days later. Now, such painful loss serves to remind us why days like today are so important. We've got a duty to pay tribute to those in the front line who risk their safety and their lives every single day to keep us safe, and to remember those like Barry who paid with their lives. But while firefighters merit our respect and our remembrance, they want and deserve our support. New research commissioned by the Fire Brigades Union found that Scottish firefighters are significantly more likely to die from cancer, heart attack, stroke, and some other diseases. The Union's Decon campaign is working hard to minimise this risk, and the Scottish Government must do more to ensure proper facilities for our firefighters. It's clear that more can be done, and quicker, to protect firefighters from exposure to toxic and cancer-causing substances. According to the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, years of underfunding means that around £500 million is needed to bring its infrastructure up to scratch. Frankly, many fire stations are outdated and dilapidated, and they lack adequate facilities. We wouldn't be expected to work in these conditions, so why should firefighters? So today, while we remember the firefighters who have been lost and thank those who serve, let's also collectively vow to continue striving to improve the safety of all of those who we rely on. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Finlay. I now call Ruth McGuire to be followed by Richard Leonard. Around 4 minutes, Ms. McGuire.
Presiding Officer, I thank Bill Kidd for bringing this important debate and allowing each of us to recognise here in our Scottish Parliament chamber the selfless and courageous acts of firefighters across not just Scotland but the world, to give them our thanks and the recognition they deserve. Presiding Officer, there are few jobs more selfless than firefighting. Imagine what it takes to throw on your protective equipment and override every human instinct to run towards danger, knowing that you might not survive, to tackle flames that never want to die in searing heat that no one should experience. We've seen it time and time again at tragedies such as the Grenfell Tower in London, the Twin Towers in New York, and most recently with the loss of Barry Martin while tackling a blaze at the Jenner's store here in our capital. And yet, those men and women we remember, and those who'd continue to come to our aid and protect our communities, would probably tell us they were just doing their job. Men like Tom Brown. Tom Brown was 53 when he lost his life. Having 28 years' experience in the service, he joined Strathclyde Fire Brigade in February 1979. He served for 20 years at Johnston, Renfrewshire, before moving to Kilwinning Fire Station. On Tuesday, the 1st of May 2007, Tom attended a fire in an unoccupied property on Bank Street, Irvine. He was one of four firefighters who entered the house that morning. All were wearing breathing apparatus. Just seconds after getting the fire under control and leaving the house, Tom collapsed. Colleagues from his Greenwatch division, based at Kilwinning Fire Station, did what they could to save him, but sadly, he'd suffered a heart attack, passing away at Crosshouse Hospital the following afternoon, Wednesday the 2nd of May 2007. He left behind his partner Natalie and stepdaughters Natasha and Jessica. Tom was described as a popular member of staff and a very able firefighter. His last act was protecting our community, tackling one of the many house fires he would have faced throughout his time in the service. Today, while remembering those firefighters like Tom who've lost their lives, our thoughts should also be with the families of those who've died in service. I would like to pay tribute to parents, siblings, partners and children who themselves are heroes. On a day we gather to remember, we should also pledge to support firefighters in whatever meaningful way we can. Risk of death should not be the norm. The report from the University of Central Lancashire, commissioned by the Fire Brigades Union, found that there were serious health risks to UK firefighters following exposure to toxic fire effluents. It revealed firefighters like Tom are dying from heart attacks at 5 times the rate of the general public. almost at three times the rate from stroke, and are significantly more likely to suffer from cancer. Understanding the effects of those harmful contaminants is vital to creating a better working environment for our brave firefighters. I'm pleased the Fire Brigades Union have continued their research with an extra 100 firefighters last month, and welcome both the additional £10 million funding uplift and the continued engagement between the Scottish Government and the Fire Service to provide better resources and to discuss current and future actions to protect firefighters. Presiding Officer, these are extraordinary public servants that we honour and remember today. To the families who have lost loved ones, we know our words will never replace them, but today and every day, we offer them our eternal gratitude. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. McGuire. And I call Richard Leonard to be followed by Keith Brown again, around 4 minutes, Mr. Leonard.
Deputy Presiding Officer, can I thank Bill Kidd for initiating this debate and welcome the new minister to her post? Last week, we marked International Workers' Memorial Day, in which we pledged to remember the dead and to fight for the living. And this week, we mark International Firefighters' Memorial Day, where we honour those working people who have paid the ultimate price, sacrificing their lives while saving the lives of others. And it's worth reminding ourselves that both are international memorial days, because our horizons must never be narrowed by geography, but widened by our common bonds and by those universal principles of solidarity, of equality, and of justice. And that is the abiding belief of the FBU as well. The very opening lines of the union's rulebook spell it out. Listen to them. The Fire Brigades Union recognises that workers, however employed, can only improve their lot by their own endeavours and organisation. A richer and fuller life can be achieved only by similar means. To this end, the Fire Brigades Union is part of the working class movement and linking itself with the international trade union and labour movement has as its ultimate aim the bringing about of the socialist system of society. So today we come together in Parliament to commemorate the memory of those firefighters who went out on a shift but who did not come home. Workers like Barry Martin, who died tragically at the tender age of 38, doing his job in this city just this year, whose grieving family we think of especially on this day, but whose family we know thinks of Barry every single day. We also commemorate the memory of those firefighters who have been exposed to killer diseases at work, which is why we must all redouble our efforts to get behind the Fire Brigades Union Vital Decon campaign. It's a campaign built on evidence gathered by Professor Anna Steck, whose findings are shocking. Compared to the general population, firefighters in Scotland are almost twice as likely to die from urinary cancers, 2.5 times more likely to die from cancer of the esophagus, more than 3.5 times more likely to die from acute myeloid leukemia, and nearly 4 times more likely to die of prostate cancer. So the Decon campaign is about saving the lives of those who save the lives of others. But it is also a recognition of how the class system fuels the gross inequalities in health, in mortality rates, and in life expectancy. As the FBU say, we don't just fight fire, we fight injustice too. Back on the 19th of January, when we debated Professor Steck's groundbreaking report, the Minister's predecessor told Parliament that, I quote, the safety, health and well-being of Scottish fire and rescue staff was a key priority. And more than once, we were told that decontamination in the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service was something to be, I quote, pursued vigorously. So I hope that over 100 days on, the new minister will update us on what progress she has made in this vigorous pursuit of tackling this injustice. Finally, on a very personal note, I want to end by recalling the life of one very special firefighter, my late friend and comrade, Enoch Humphreys, a former national president of the Fire Brigades Union, a man of principle, born of experience, forged in fire, someone who taught me so much. He never got used to injustice and inequality. He battled against it all of his life. Enoch Humphreys never looked away and never forgot. So it is the task of those who follow in his footsteps, those in the union, those of us elected to this parliament, which he campaigned so tirelessly for, to keep that red flame of courage alive, to keep those socialist principles burning brightly, and to rekindle our faith that we can build the kind of better future which humanity richly deserves.
Thank you very much, Mr. Leonard. I now call Keith Brown to be followed by Mark Griffin. Around 4 minutes, Mr. Brown.
Thank you. I very much welcome the opportunity to contribute to this debate and also congratulate my colleague Bill Kidd for securing a debate on such an important topic. Today is, as we've heard, International Firefighters Day or Firefighters Memorial Day, an annual observance allowing us the opportunity to recognise the immensely important role that firefighters play in our society and, again, as we've heard, to honour the memory of those who have lost their lives in the line of duty. Scotland, though, has an important place in the development of firefighting. The city of Edinburgh, our capital, is believed to have had the first municipal fire service formed in 1824. And today, the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service is now the world's fourth largest fire and rescue service. Just last week, like other members, I attended a wreath-laying ceremony in Alloa as part of International Workers' Memorial Day, in memory of all those who have been killed at work, and rightly so. But it's also right that we should have a special day to mark the particular sacrifice of those men and women in our fire and rescue service. Firefighters Memorial Day does, of course, have a particular poignancy in Scotland, as we've heard, so soon after the death of firefighter Barry Martin, as a result of injuries sustained whilst tackling a blaze in the former Jenner's department store here in Edinburgh. But firefighter deaths have become mercifully more infrequent in recent years. Barry Martin was the first firefighter to be killed in the line of duty since 2009, indeed the first since the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service was formed. And I hope it will be a very long time indeed before there is another. But, of course, the nature of the job is such that danger is ever present. Bill Kidd's motion, understandably, acknowledges the crew at his local fire station at Knightswood, and I'd like to take the opportunity to mention firefighters whole time and retained, that protect the communities of my constituency from the fire stations in Alloa, Tillicoutray, Bridge of Allen and Dunblane. Firefighters are a special breed. They willingly and deliberately put themselves into situations that are incredibly dangerous to protect us, the public. They are the ones who run towards danger when others are fleeing. And at any time on their shift or when they are on call, the bell could ring and off they go, ready to face whatever danger awaits. But I'm also pleased that today's motion highlights the Red Plaque Project. As has been outlined already, this important endeavour seeks to recognise and remember the contribution and sacrifice of those firefighters killed in the line of duty by placing a distinctive plaque as near as possible to the location where they died, commemorating an important moment in a community's history and offering a place for reflection for the family, friends and colleagues and those from the wider community affected by the events around the loss of a firefighter. The project has been creating memorials since 2017, funded by the Firefighters 100 Lottery, a charitable initiative run by the Fire Brigades Union. One such plaque in my constituency commemorates John Noble, who lost his life in the line of duty on the 23rd of January 2008. I actually met John at an event about a week before his death. His red plaque was presented on the anniversary of his death, the 23rd of January 2019. John was a watch manager at Alloa Fire Station, and he was on his way to a call-out at Strathavon Primary School in Dollar, the place where all three of my children went and where one of them was on the day in question. When the fire engine that John was involved in a fatal accident, and with more than 26 years of experience in the fire service, The 46-year-old left behind his wife, Lorraine, and two children. The fire engine had a crew of five and were responding to a smoke alarm that activated at the primary school. When the driver attempted to turn into a bend in the place between Tillicoutry and Dollar, for those that know it, it's called the Dollar Bends, has a lot of sharp bends in it. The fire engine left the road near Tillicoutry and collided with a tree, killing John and injuring four of his colleagues, one seriously. The caller was later found out to be a false alarm. And that story underlines the random nature of the threat to life that firefighters face on a daily basis as they go about their work protecting the public. It also highlights the sad fact that even a false alarm can result in the death of a firefighter. So it is right that we take the time to remember and honour the memory of John Noble and all those firefighters killed in the line of duty. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. I now call Mark Griffin to be followed by Stephanie Callan in around 4 minutes. Mr. Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I also want to congratulate Bill Kidd for bringing this debate to the Chamber to allow us to mark Firefighters Memorial Day 2023. And I echo, I think, what all speakers have said, that this is particularly poignant as we remember Barry Martin. I too want to pass on my thanks, as the motion says, to firefighters serving communities across Scotland and recognise their courage and dedication. And I also fully agree that, as the motion says, all fire stations should have safe work practices. Now, Russell Finlay detailed some of the work that the FBU have done to look into the conditions in stations up and down the country. And it's incredibly alarming as we look to recognise their bravery and sacrifice. So too, we must also look at the conditions that we are asking them to work in every single day. In my region, 60% of stations, including Bells Hill, Motherwell, Kilsyth and Coatbridge, are considered to be in bad or poor condition. In Cumbernauld, the station requires remedial action, is considered in bad condition and has scaffolding supporting the structure. But crucially, it lacks the single occupancy showers, which are absolutely vital to properly decontaminate. The FBU has raised concerns that firefighters are being unnecessarily exposed to carcinogenic fire particles for long periods of time, and so those decontamination facilities are absolutely crucial. Firefighters who work so hard to ensure the safety of people in our communities need to be well equipped, well resourced, well protected and well paid. We owe that to them and their memory, but that includes giving them those facilities to properly decontaminate. And on Friday, when we marked International Workers' Memorial Day, a day to remember the dead and fight for the living, the FBU, with the SDEC and the wider labour movement, came out in support of my proposed Scottish Employment Injuries Advisory Council Bill. And, Presiding Officer, I want to put on record how grateful I am for the support of the FBU, because it's their work which is making the case for a devolved employment injuries benefit that works for their members and can bring that benefit system into the 21st century. And we've debated the issue previously, thanks to Maggie Chapman and others involved in a debate of the work through its FBU decon campaign, with the help of Professor Anna Steck from the University of Central Lancashire. And that work has been absolutely groundbreaking. Not commissioned by any government, it confirms the World Health Organization finding that firefighting is a cancer-causing occupation. It identifies an epidemiological case in Scotland for prescribing cancers in firefighters in Scotland for the new employment injuries assistance benefit. They've been using Scottish firefighter death certificates, and I think that makes a case that the government absolutely can't ignore. And it's a principle of fair work that workers have an effective voice in government. Having an advisory council where firefighters have a direct role advising government on what the benefits should look like to support them is fundamental to that idea. And they can only do that through an independent statutory council without the fear or favour of government, who are ultimately their bosses. Firefighters know their workplaces. They know how the lack of decontamination facilities are giving them cancer. We must give them a voice. We must give them a voice in getting justice through the employment injuries benefit system and their place on a council advising government. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Griffin. And I call Stephanie Callaghan to be followed by Maggie Chapman, around 4 minutes. Ms Callaghan.
Presiding Officer, I also thank Bill Kidd for bringing this debate to Chamber and Firefighters Memorial Day. And it's always a tragedy when a professional loses their life in the line of duty. And so I stand today in solidarity to remember those who have made the ultimate sacrifice and to recognise the dedication and courage of every single one of Scotland's 3,531 whole-time firefighters. I also want to thank the Fire Brigades Union for sending across today's briefing and for their endless work advocating for firefighters' rights. Firefighters are at the very heart of our communities. And during 2021-2022, the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service attended 95,709 incidents. They provide a lifeline to our communities when we face danger, and they dedicate time in our local communities, educating us and fitting smoke alarms on behalf of those who cannot. Our firefighters undertake a variety of roles that share the same goal. All of them prioritise the safety of our communities. And this year marks the 60th anniversary of local firefighters Stanley McIntosh, MBE, and Joseph Calderwood, who lost their lives in a tragic blaze in Holytown in my constituency. Earlier this year, in honour of their sacrifice, a red plaque, which we've heard about earlier from the Fire Brigades Union, was placed at Motherwell Fire Station to ensure everyone in Lanarkshire remembers their names and to remind local people of their selfless dedication to protecting our community. Presiding Officer, in response to Firefighters Memorial Day, I would also like to raise awareness of all the other everyday sacrifices that firefighters make, because the sacrifice of firefighting does not stop at the fire station. The invaluable DECON campaign, as we've heard, is informed by groundbreaking research by the University of Central Lancashire and plays a vital role in raising awareness, highlighting the needs for firefighters to protect themselves, their family and others from toxic contaminants. No one should have their health worsen just from going to work, yet firefighters are routinely faced with traumatic and high-stress environments and exposed to toxic and carcinogenic contaminants. It's harrowing that firefighters are at increased risk of cancer, as we've heard already, and often only once they have reached the terminal stage, dying up to 20 years earlier than the general public from these rare cancers. Additionally, exposure to toxic contaminants is causing higher rates of mental health issues. And findings from the 2023 UK firefighter contamination revealed that those who remained in contaminated PPE for over 4 hours after incidents were twice as likely to report mental health disorders as their peers. These findings are an evident call for further investigation in firefighting health monitoring and suffice PPE management, where reducing exposure from contaminants is pertinent to protecting our firefighters and their families' health and wellbeing. Presiding Officer, sacrifices are not only made by the firefighter, but also by every partner and family member, patiently waiting for their loved one to return home. Being a firefighter means prioritising the safety of our communities, often at the expense of sacred family time, and missing big occasions like birthdays, weddings, moments the rest of us often take for granted. The experience of being married to a firefighter was generously shared by Amber, and she wrote, "The truth is, being a fire wife is rarely glamorous. It's extremely lonely nights, followed by long days." Yet Amber would not change this for the world, because she knows being a firefighter is her husband's calling, not just his job. So on Firefighters Memorial Day, let us share our shared gratitude to those firefighters currently serving our communities and the families supporting them and all those who have fallen. So in closing, it really is extraordinary individuals that we honour here today, including firefighters Stanley McIntosh and Joseph Calderwood, and more recently, Barry Martin and Ewan Williamson, as well as every other firefighter who's nobly made the ultimate sacrifice, more than 2,500 in total. To all the firefighters out there, thank you for keeping us safe.
Thank you very much, Ms Callaghan. There are a number of members still wishing to participate in the debate. To allow all of them to do so, I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes, and I invite Bill Kidd to move such a motion.
Moved, Presiding Officer. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr Kidd. The question is that the debate be extended by up to 30 minutes. Are we all agreed? That is agreed. I call now Maggie Chapman to be followed by Gordon MacDonald. Around 4 minutes, Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Bill Kidd for lodging this motion so that we can, as we should, mark Firefighters Memorial Day today. And I welcome some firefighters and FBU members to the gallery. This year's Firefighters Day is perhaps especially poignant because of the tragic death of firefighter Barry Martin in Edinburgh in January. My sincere condolences to Barry's family, friends and colleagues. As the motion highlights, the Fire Brigades Union has created the Red Plaque Scheme, which seeks to mark, with the placing of a red plaque, where or close to where firefighters have lost their lives in the course of their duties. I was privileged a few weeks ago to attend the Red Plaque Unveiling Ceremony at Blackness Road Fire Station in Dundee. Two plaques were installed on the wall of the station, one to honour John Buist, who died after being trapped by burning jute bales in a warehouse in April 1962, and one to honour William Carnegie, who was killed in a fall while attending a fire on Mains Road, also in 1962. We remember them today, just as we remember Barry Martin and each one of the firefighters who has lost their lives in Scotland, the UK and beyond. Turning to the FBU's decon campaign. Over the last couple of years, it has become increasingly plain that firefighters are exposed to toxins and other conditions that have negative impacts on their health. Professor Anna Steck's excellent work on Scottish firefighters' occupation, cancer and disease mortality rates highlights the extent of the impact that the work of firefighting has on our firefighters. And the International Agency for Research of Cancer, part of the World Health Organization, has assessed firefighting to be a carcinogenic occupation. This is why the FBU has developed its decon campaign. Bill Kidd highlighted the campaign's key asks: regular health screening and monitoring, clear recording of occupational information, including on death certificates, legislation that enables compensation, and of course, investment in personnel, training, and the facilities and infrastructure needed to decontaminate effectively after incidents and limit exposure in the first place. Recently, I was pleased to visit a fire station with FBU colleagues to better understand how things worked on the ground as far as safety and decontamination is concerned. Improvements are clearly underway in several areas, and firefighters are supporting each other with the culture change that is required. One of the FBU's posters calls on firefighters to shower within the hour. As soon as possible after an incident, to shower to remove as many contaminants as possible. Now, we know that some stations do not have running water, so firefighters have to go home to shower, taking contaminants home to their families. We must address this. Where showers are available, some don't have soap or other detergents. Sometimes contaminated personnel need to walk past other colleagues through carpeted areas to get to shower facilities. We need to rethink the provision of soap, very basic things like that, and other things, to ensure that they are as close to arrival points as possible to limit the spread of contaminants through the stations. Clear policies and procedures for limiting exposure and prioritising decontamination must become ingrained in the culture and practices across the service. The FBU's decon campaign is a call for all of us to act, for government to plan the investment and implement that investment appropriately, for the Fire and Rescue Service itself to ensure policies and procedures are appropriate and adequate, and that training meets the needs of the evolving service, and for firefighters to be aware of what they need to do to keep themselves, their colleagues, and their families safe. This campaign is vital for the long-term sustainability of the service. Firefighting must be a profession that people want to join and stay in without facing additional and disproportionate risks of stroke, cancer, heart attack and early death. To conclude, Presiding Officer, we rely on firefighters at some of the worst moments of our lives. At these moments, we expect firefighters to be there, equipped as best they can, to save our lives, our families, our communities. It is only right that we recognise and respect that. For them to be there to do that, they need our support now. Just a week on from International Workers' Memorial Day, we must remember the dead and fight for the living. I pledge to continue to work with the FBU to do just that. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. I now call Gordon MacDonald to be followed by Katie Clark. Around 4 minutes, Mr MacDonald.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I also thank Bill Kidd for securing this important debate. The annual International Firefighters Day is to honour and pay tribute to the hard work of past and present firefighters while protecting the life and property of people. Firefighters put their life at risk while working tirelessly to prevent the damage caused by fires. In the last 100 years, over 40 firefighters have died while serving in Scotland. And today we remember them and their comrades across the world who have given their lives in the service of their communities. In recent times, tragically, two of that number were members of the Fire and Rescue Service that served in Edinburgh, and they paid the ultimate price and lost their lives as a result of firefighting in this city. And as Bill Kidd mentioned, in July 2009, firefighter Ewan Williamson died whilst fighting a blaze in the Balmoral Bar in the city's Dalry Road, and much more recently we saw the tragic death of firefighter Barry Martin, who died as a result of his injuries that were sustained firefighting in the vacant Jenner store on Princess Street in January of this year. In recognising the ultimate tragedy of this loss of life, we should never forget that across the country, firefighters can and do sustain injuries, sometimes life-changing, whilst protecting the public from harm. In acknowledging the death of firefighters Williamson and Martin and others across the world, we should also remember that those that sustain injuries, four of firefighter Barry Martin's colleagues, were also hospitalised as a result of the Jenner's incident, but thankfully their injuries were such that they were discharged from hospital relatively soon. While it's important that we acknowledge the annual Firefighters Memorial Day, I would also like to recognise the work of the Fire Brigades Union and their support for the Red Plaque Scheme that recognises and honours as many fallen firefighters as possible for their selfless commitment to protecting others. The Red Plaque Scheme is funded by the Firefighters 100 Lottery, which was born out of the plans to mark the centenary of the Fire Brigades Union. It is run independently and was set up to help commemorate the bravery and sacrifice of firefighters killed and injured in the line of duty, and to establish a fund for the future benefit of firefighters, their bereaved families and the firefighting profession. So far, the scheme has seen a number of plaques installed in Scotland, these being in Aberdeen, Dundee, Inverary, Dollar, Paisley, Motherwell, Glasgow and Edinburgh on Dalry Road to commemorate the death of firefighter Ewan Williamson. Sadly, in time, there will be at least one more to mark the death of Barry Martin. The list of towns and cities I've just shared shows that right across Scotland, our firefighters have and do put themselves in harm's way, sometimes costing their own lives while protecting the public. We, of course, know that other workers tragically lose their lives at work and they are remembered on International Workers' Memorial Day, but it is right and proper that firefighters are acknowledged separately, because while others evacuate or flee from danger, they head towards it to render their three main aims: to save lives, protect property and provide humanitarian services. For this, we are eternally grateful, and on this day especially, but also on every other day, we thank them and their families for the work they do on our behalf, and especially remember those who gave their lives doing so.
Thank you, Mr MacDonald. And I now call the final speaker in the open debate, Katie Clark, around 4 minutes. Ms Clark.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I congratulate Bill Kidd on securing this debate and thank him for putting down the motion. As he pointed out, this is an international day and the issues raised are international, where firefighters put themselves at danger. in the interests of others, and I associate myself with all of the tributes that have been made to firefighters who have lost their lives. Firefighters Memorial Day is, as I say, an international day, a day of solidarity, and a day to remember all firefighters and fire and rescue service workers who have lost their lives. And as has been said in this debate, over 2,500 UK firefighters have lost their lives serving their communities, and many thousands more have been injured. The health risks to firefighters are now very clear, with higher death rates, higher rates of heart attacks, higher cancer and leukaemia rates, and excess cancer mortality rates linked to different types of exposures and fire toxins. My office recently submitted Freedom of Information requests to the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service about the conditions in our fire stations. In total, 75% of Scotland's fire stations are assessed as being of bad or poor suitability. Around 45% of fire stations are assessed as being in either bad or poor condition. In total, around 30% of Scotland's fire stations do not have dedicated female toilets, and about 33% of Scotland's fire stations do not have dedicated male toilets. Around 40% of Scotland's fire stations do not have dedicated female showers, and around 26% of Scotland's fire stations do not have drying facilities. Interim Chief Ross Haggart estimated to the Criminal Justice Committee that £138 million is needed to address this issue. But he also cited a £630 million backlog on the fire services capital budget. Despite representations being made strongly, the Scottish Government is cutting the budget in real terms over the next year. And of course, we also know that between 2012 and 2021, almost 1,100 firefighters' jobs were lost across Scotland, around 15% of the workforce. Last Friday was Workers' Memorial Day. The message then and the message now must be, we must remember the dead, we must fight for the living. And what that means in reality in this chamber is we must put our words, we must put our actions where our words are, and we must commit resources to ensure that firefighters in this country are provided with safe systems of work.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Clark. I now call on Siobhan Brown to respond to the debate. Minister, for around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And firstly, I'd like to thank Bill Kidd for raising this very important debate and bringing it to the wider attention of the Parliament. It's fitting that we gather to remember firefighters across the world who gave their lives to protect others and honour the memories of those exceptional and very brave people. This has been brought into sharp focus for us all in Scotland this year with the very sad death of the firefighter Barry Martin in January. And today we've heard also about Tom Brown in Irvine, John Noble in Alloa, and Stanley McIntosh, Joseph Coldwood, just to name a few. And my deepest condolences go out to the families, friends, loved ones and colleagues also at this time. The SFRS continues to mark the tragedies which took place at Cheapside Street and Kilburnie Street in Glasgow in the 60s and 70s to ensure that firefighters who lost their lives are never forgotten. It is often said that firefighters are those who run towards danger while everyone else runs away. And of course they train and they prepare so they can do this as safely and as effectively as possible. But whenever there is a loss, it is a clear reminder of the courage that our firefighters demonstrate every day of their working lives. As much as firefighters face known risks when they attend an emergency, it is right that we also support and protect them from lesser known and the more silent risks. And in this respect, I would like to thank and acknowledge the significant work of the Fire Brigades Union in commissioning their important research with the University of Central Lancashire and in production of the report that was discussed at an earlier debate in January this year. And I'd also like to welcome members of the FBU to the gallery today. The safety, health and well-being of our firefighting staff who work so hard to protect communities in some of the most challenging environments and is the utmost importance to the Scottish Government and the Scottish Fire Rescue Service. And as the employer of firefighters in Scotland, the FBU's campaign, their research, and subsequent conclusions are primarily a matter for the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. SFRS has been engaged with this work for a number of years and has met with Professor Anna Steck at the University of Central Lancashire on several occasions to achieve a deeper understanding of the important research that she is doing to offer the SFRS cooperation and support and to identify the actions which are needed to minimise harm to firefighters. Yes?
Katie Clark.
I hear what she says, but I understand that 14 fire stations in Scotland do not have running water. Would she agree with me that that's unacceptable and needs to be addressed urgently?
Minister.
I thank Katie Clark for her intervention, and I met with the SFRS earlier this week, and they raised these points with me, and I totally agree, and I know that there are plans in place to rectify that situation as a matter of urgency. Sorry, I'm just trying to find my place. I'm also aware of the debate, aware that as a result of the debate in January, the previous Minister of Community Safety swiftly engaged with both SFRS and the FBU, and meetings took place in February between the previous Minister and the SFRS senior leadership team at the SFRS headquarters at Cambus Lang. The Minister also met with FBU and Dr. Steck in February of this year, and among others, issues discuss the wider health monitoring for firefighters, and I'm meeting the FBU later, I think, next week. I'm pleased to say that since those discussions, the SFRS is working closely with Professor Steck and the FBU on developing further research and analysis on health monitoring and will progress on detailed proposals over the next 12 months. And I understand that the FBU has welcomed this development. I know that the Deakin campaign also raises the need for recognition of occupational risks in recognition of firefighting as an occupational risk, both in terms of benefits and in pensions by the DWP and in terms of public record keeping. And I'm pleased to say that officials have been progressing positive discussions with other devolved nations and Westminster on issues such as the industrial injuries disablement benefit. Yes?
Mark Griffin.
Industrial injuries disablement benefit is now fully devolved. It's entirely within the gift of the Scottish Government to set out its entitlement. Will the Minister commit to look at the particular cancers that are affecting firefighters and look at prescribing those for the purposes of employment injuries assistance, which, like I said, is fully devolved entitlement now to the Scottish Government?
Minister, I can give you the time back for the intervention.
Thank you. I thank the Member for the intervention, and yes, I'll be happy to look into that on your behalf. I fully recognise the risk of contaminants and that can cause to firefighters, and I want Scotland to be the forefront of moves to tackle that threat. SFRS has a long-established management of contaminants working group, which looks at technical, procedural and cultural solutions to mitigate the risk of the SFRS personnel and any others who may be affected by the actions of SFRS personnel being exposed to contaminants. The group includes representation from the Fire Brigade Union and has links to external specialists and is supported by the highest levels of SFRS staff. I know that Richard Leonard asked for progress in his speech, but SFRS has already made significant practical changes in procedures, equipment and facilities to reduce firefighter contact with equipment which could contain contaminants harmful to health. And this important work will continue. And practical examples of these changes include ensuring firefighting equipment is properly cleaned and stored, encouraging crews to shower as quickly as possible on return to station grounds, and all SFRS buildings have been audited and reviewed to minimise the risk of contamination. Procedures have also been developed to ensure firefighters in some rural fire stations which lack showering facilities have appropriate decontamination solutions in place. A number of steps have also been taken to mitigate risks, including supplying specialist decontamination wipes and the trial of station zoning systems to limit any potential spread. The Scottish Government has continued the commitment to support for the SFRS service delivery and reform with a further uplift of $14.4 million budget cover between 2023 and 2024. And I must reiterate that these decisions, the decisions on how its budget, including the capital allocation of the $32.5 million, is a matter for the Scottish Fire Rescue Service Board. Difficult decisions have to be taken on budgets, particularly for capital investments, but we've maintained the $32.5 million capital budget for SFRS in 23 to 24 to invest in buildings, fleet and equipment. If I can just touch on a few of the members, and I thank you all for your very moving and passionate contributions today. I'd like to highlight, first of all, Keith Brown, who highlighted the threat to life that every day firefighters go to, even if they may not die in a fire, as your John Noble died in a car accident while in the line of duty. And can I also take the time to thank you for all your work as Cabinet Secretary for the past...
Minister, if you could address the microphone so that we pick it up.
In closing, Presiding Officer, I again thank Bill Kidd for the opportunity to mark Firefighter Memorial Day and discuss the wider issues around the FBU decon campaign. I will continue to discuss the issues of decontamination and wider health of firefighters with the FBU and SFRS through my regular meetings with them to ensure that progress continues to be made on this important issue. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I suspend this meeting of Parliament until 2:30.